So my subject here this afternoon is World War II, and I'm eventually going to tell you a little parable that to which I've given the title, A Tale of Three Cities, How the United States Won World War II. But I want to begin with a personal anecdote that might at first strike you as having nothing whatsoever to do with World War II, but there is a point to it. So I'm a bicycle rider, and I was taking a bicycle ride with a group of, it turned out to be mostly lawyers whom I didn't know very well, down the Big Sur coast in California. Some of you probably know that. It's a spectacular piece of real estate, the beauty of which is rivaled only by central Oklahoma. So you have to imagine the scene. There are about 100, 150 people milling around in the fog in Carmel, California, in the parking lot of the motel where we stayed from. And as I say, I didn't know most of these people. They're all dressed in spandex, middle-aged people. It's kind of a peculiar scene. And this fellow came up to me and he said, I don't think I've seen you on this ride before. My name's Jack McGlynn. I'm a lawyer in San Francisco. How about you? I said, well, pleased to meet you, Jack. My name's David Kennedy. I teach history at Stanford University. Oh, he said, I know all about you guys. Well, I should have been on my mettle right then. He said, you historians, he said, all you do is you make up these what-if scenarios. What if this had happened? How would things be different? What if this hadn't happened? How would the course of events have gone differently and so on? Well, as you might imagine, I thought that was a pretty drastically reductionist description of my life's work. But before I could muster any kind of cogent reply, he said, I've got one for you. And you could hear the inner voice saying, Mr. Smarty Pants Professor. He said, what if on November 22nd, 1963, it was not John F. Kennedy who fell to the assassin's bullet, but instead on that date, the Soviet premier, Nikita Khrushchev, had been assassinated? How would the subsequent course of events have been different? Now, as you might imagine, I had never thought of that scenario before. And again, as I was trying to muster some kind of an answer, he said, well, I'll tell you. Again, you should have seen it coming. He said, there's one thing we can say with absolute certainty about the history after that date, if it had been Khrushchev and not Kennedy who was killed, Aristotle Onassis would not have married Mrs. Khrushchev. Now, it's very gratifying to me to see that most of the people in this room got the joke. Because when I've tried to share that story with my Stanford undergraduate students, they just look at me blankly. If you don't carry around a mental picture of Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis and especially Mrs. Khrushchev in a joke lesson. So humor is generationally specific, we've just proved. All right. But Jack McGlynn actually had a serious point. History is not a laboratory science. We can't go to the laboratory bench and titrate some event and add this element and withdraw that one and see how the equation plays out differently. So we do, in fact, whether explicitly or implicitly, rely on what-if scenarios to try to test our thinking about the chain of cause and consequence and the importance of this factor and the other factor and so on. So here's a serious what-if question that I'd like to use to frame my remarks here this afternoon. What if the United States had lost World War II? How would the world that we've all lived in ever since be different? Now, that's the most robust, strong form of the question. There's a slightly or somewhat more responsible form of the question, and that is, what if the United States had won World War II, but had won it on a different timetable, fighting on the basis of a different strategic doctrine with a different configuration of forces, different portion of effort devoted to different theaters of battle and so on? How would the world that we've lived in ever since have been different? So that's the question I'd like you to keep in mind as we progress through this. And I'm going to try to return to the question, who won World War II, at the end of these remarks. And the question is a little more tricky than you might think going in. Now, there's a premise that underlies these remarks, and there's a proposition that I want to try to argue. The premise is that World War II was a transformative event. It's a transformative event in world history, and it is a transformative event with respect to the history of this society. The proposition that I want to argue is that the transformative effects of World War II did not, especially with respect to this society, did not just happen. They were not incidents of war. They flowed from some very shrewdly taken strategic decisions about how to fight a particular war with a particular configuration of forces on the basis of a particular strategic doctrine and on a particular timetable. That's the argument I'm going to try to make. Now, how transformative was the war? Some of you might have read Philip Roth's novel, American Pastoral, which is a wonderful evocation of how the greatest generation, the post-World War II generation, confronted its children in the 1960s in the Vietnam era. But in the beginning parts of that novel, he tries to set the scene for the reader of what this country felt like right after World War II. And he has a phrase in there that I thought was quite catchy. He said, it was the greatest moment of collective inebriation in all of American history. That the country was giddy with a sense of confidence in the future, congratulations on a just war, justly fought and rightly won. And it was a period of 2.5 or 3 decades of sustained economic growth, widely shared economic growth, a moment, one of the most benign and celebrated moments in all of American history. So that's one touchstone, is just to remember how good things were on many different indexes in that post-war couple of decades. But there's another text that I'd like to use here, again, to frame these remarks a bit. And this comes from a speech that Winston Churchill gave in Parliament on August 17th, 1945, just 2 days after the Japanese had signaled their intention to surrender. Formal surrender is a couple of weeks later. And Churchill gave a speech in which he tried to sum up for his countrymen and others what he thought would be the consequences now of this great titanic conflict that had come to a close. And he said a lot of things. It was a typically Baroque Churchillian production. But there was one sentence in that speech when I read the text that just jumped off the page at me, not only because of its lapidary accuracy, but also because he used a peculiar form of diction that I suppose must have been still current in British English at that time, but has long since passed out of American English usage. He rendered the United States as a plural noun. And the sentence that caught my attention says simply, this is August 17, 1945, he said, the United States stand at this moment at the summit of the world. The United States stand at this moment at the summit of the world. Now, we might argue that with certain qualifications, that has been substantially true ever since. But more importantly, I think, instead of looking forward from 1945, let's look back for a moment and just reflect on how absolutely improbable that statement, accurate as it was in 1945, would have been from the standpoint of the last full peacetime year in the United States, 1940. Just 5 years back in time, that conclusion that Churchill reached in August of 1945 would have been absolutely insane as a claim to truth. So let's just take our minds back to 1940 for a moment and remember what it looked like. 1940 was the 11th year of the event we now know, called for generations now, the Great Depression. Unemployment had averaged 17% for the entire decade of the 1930s, never went below 14%, was still about 15% in 1940. Though the federal government did not at that time compile poverty statistics, historians have reconstructed poverty standards for that time, and our best estimate is that 45% of all white households lived in poverty in 1940, 45%, and 95% of all African-American households. This was an economically stricken country, and it had been for more than a decade. One Hoover administration and two Roosevelt administrations had not found an exit from this crisis, though, as we heard this morning, the Roosevelt administration made some progress against the Depression, but certainly did not banish it from the land. So this, and if we turn to the international scene and try to contemplate the changes that are coming just shortly over the horizon of the future after 1940, the contrast with what's coming in the international scene is even greater than on the domestic front. In 1940, within the memory of most adults, the United States had refused to join the League of Nations at the conclusion of World War I, even though the League was the brainchild of the American president, Woodrow Wilson. The United States had enacted the highest tariffs in its history, first the Fordney McCumber tariff in 1922, and then the notorious Hawley Smoot tariff in 1930. It had passed the first immigration restriction law in its history that put a numerical cap for the first time on number of immigrants allowed into the country in the notorious National Origins Act of 1924. The Congress of the United States had passed five separate so-called neutrality statutes in the 1930s, intended to keep the United States out of any international entanglement in the event that eventually we know it was World War II. And of course, the American government had insisted on the repayment of those treasury loans made to the British and French during World War I, a fact of international financial life that badly distorted international capital flows and capital markets. So on just about every index we can think of, not only was this an economically blighted country, but it was a decidedly and deeply isolationist country. I think the conclusion is warranted that the 1930s, in fact, were the most isolationist moment in all of American history. Now, just imagine you were walking down the streets of any great American city, Tulsa, Oklahoma City, Norman, in 1940, and you encountered a street corner speaker who was saying something like the following: "My fellow Americans, in this year of grace 1940, I'm here to tell you that this economically sick country of ours that has been saddled with this Great Depression for the last decade and more is about to emerge onto a sustained plateau of economic growth that will be so robust that by 1960, just 20 years hence, we will have gone from a majority renter society to a majority homeowner society, and we'll be launched on a pathway of growth that will continue down to the end of the century and drastically expand the size of our middle class and shower benefits on this society, the likes of which we've never seen." And our hypothetical speaker goes on, "I'm here to tell you, my fellow citizens, that our isolationist country, which turned its back on the League of Nations, insisted on the repayment of all those international loans, capped immigration at 120,000 or 150,000 visas a year in 1924, passed all those neutrality acts in the 1930s in the last decade, this society is going to emerge as the international leader of a new set of multilateral institutions. One of them will be called the United Nations, the successor to the League. Its headquarters will be in our principal city of New York. We will create new institutions. One will be called the World Bank to aid in the reconstruction of war-torn countries. Another will be called the International Monetary Fund to stabilize international exchange rates and underwrite more international trade. There'll be something called NATO. There'll be something called the Marshall Plan. And these efforts will so energize the global economy that by the end of this century, my fellow citizens, we will have to invent a new word to describe these effects. The word will be globalization." Now, anybody who'd made that speech on the corner of any American city in 1940 would have been hauled off as certifiable. There was nothing in the historical record as of that moment to justify those kinds of predictions. And yet we know what happens, that by 1945, the scenario that our hypothetical speaker in 1940 is merchandising out there on the streets becomes the reality. And as I said at the outset, has become remains substantially the reality ever since. Now, how did this happen? The intervening event, of course, is World War II, and especially American participation in it. My students at Stanford, sometimes if I get them to speak frankly about how they regard the study of history, they've been known to say, in great frankness, they say, "Well, Professor Kennedy, you know, the trouble with the study of history is it's just one damn thing after another." And if you take nothing else away from this presentation this morning, I hope it will be the thought that what I'm talking about here today is not a case of just one damn thing after another, that the result we got that deposited the United States, as Churchill said, at the summit of the world in 1945, coming from the position it had been in 1940, is the result of some very shrewd decisions taken as the United States approached war and then decisions that were ratified as the war went on. Now, I'm going to resort to a little crib sheet here because I'm going to quote some famous people, and I don't want to get it wrong. So I've brought us up now to essentially the outbreak, the moment of American entry into the war on December 7th, 1941. I want to share with you some remarks at that time about what the implications and consequences of American belligerency would be. And the first of these remarks came from the mouth of Adolf Hitler. We have an ear witness to what he said when he heard the news of the Pearl Harbor attack. The ear witness is recorded in William Shirer's famous book about the rise and fall of the Third Reich. And Hitler heard the news of the Pearl Harbor attack. It was news to him. The Japanese did not bother to tell him they were going to do this. He said as follows, "Now it is impossible for us to lose the war because we now have an ally, Japan, who has never been vanquished in 3,000 years. So Hitler's first reaction to the news of Pearl Harbor is to be exhilarated, energized, thinking that now victory is a clinch. What we're permitted to believe is essentially the same moment in time. Hitler's great adversary, Winston Churchill, hears the same news in the same manner over the news wire. And we don't know what he said at that moment. We don't have any witness to that effect. But we do have, in Churchill's memoir of the war, his attempt to recreate for the reader his state of mind when he heard the news of Pearl Harbor. And here is the essence of what he said. He says, "So the United States was in the war, up to the neck and into the death. So we had won after all. England would live. I went to bed and slept the sleep of the saved and the thankful." Now, we know how this story comes out, and we know that Churchill had it right and Hitler had it wrong, but the remarkable thing from the historian's point of view is that here we are, December 7th, 1941, and these two individuals, Hitler and Churchill, each of whom had high incentive to appraise and correctly gauge the implications of American belligerency, made absolutely 180-degree opposite appraisals of how that was going to play out. A reminder that as late as this date, in December 7th, 1941, the world did not know when the United States would fight, how it would fight, what resources it would bring to bear, what its basic strategic doctrines would be, and so on. All right, third remark, also from December 1941. This comes from the pen of the German foreign minister, Joachim von Ribbentrop, who wrote a lengthy memo for his Führer just about 2 weeks after Pearl Harbor and tried to explain in considerable detail how the American entry into the war had now changed the strategic equation. And this is a much more considered document than Hitler's outburst on December 7th. And here's the essence of what Ribbentrop said. He said, "We have just 1 year to cut Russia off from her military supplies. If we don't succeed, and the munitions potential of the United States joins up with the manpower potential of the Russians, the war will enter a phase in which we shall only be able to win it with difficulty." Now, that turns out to have been a very sensible and accurate understanding of what would be the consequences of American entry. Note the time frame he mentions, 1 year, and note the resources that he thinks the Americans are now going to bring to bear. It's not manpower, but munitions. All right, fourth and final remark from this part of the historical record. And here I'm going to break the time frame of December 1941 for what I hope you'll agree is a justifiable reason, because this remark comes from the pen of Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto, who was, of course, the commander-in-chief of the Japanese Imperial Fleet, the man who eventually is given the task of starting the war with the Americans by attacking Pearl Harbor. He wrote the remark I'm about to share with you in September 1940, 15 months or so before the Pearl Harbor attack, at a time when U.S.-Japanese relations are starting to go seriously south. And here's what he wrote in a memo to his civilian prime minister, Fumimaro Kanoya. He said, "If I am told to fight regardless of the consequences, I shall run wild for the first 6 months or a year." Notice the similarity of time frame to Ribbentrop. "But I have utterly no confidence for a second or third year. I hope, therefore, Mr. Prime Minister, that you will endeavor to avoid a Japanese-American war." Now, again, from the historian's point of view, this is an exceptional document. The man who was eventually tasked with starting the war, advising his government a year and a half or so earlier not to get into it. Now, what Ribbentrop and Yamamoto knew is one of the most ancient lessons in the history of warfare, first articulated millennia ago by the great Chinese theorist Sun Tzu. And the first rule of warfare, says Sun Tzu, is know your enemy. And the second rule of warfare is know yourself. Hitler did not know his enemy. Ribbentrop did, and Yamamoto did. And what they knew is something that Franklin Roosevelt put in his own very homely way in a famous address as he was introducing the Lend-Lease Bill into the Congress in early 1941. He said, "We must become, or we shall become, the great arsenal of democracy." Note what he did not say. He did not say we will become the sword of democracy. He did not even say we'll become the shield of democracy. We'll become the great arsenal of democracy. And that notion of the United States as the munitions center is at the very core of American grand strategy in World War II. And unlike the histories of most countries that wage protracted wars of this sort, the United States managed to stick to that strategy in all of its essentials right down to the conclusion of the war. All right, let me, I'm going to now get to the fabled, or the promised fable or parable of the Tale of Three Cities as a way of trying to illustrate or summarize the main elements of this grand American strategy. Some of you have been asking me through the morning, what are the three cities? And I've refrained from revealing the secret until now. Now it can be told. And I should say, this is just it's a teaching device. It's a way of summing up a lot of fairly complicated data. I could maybe use three other cities, but I'm going to use these three. The first is Rouen, on the banks of the Seine River in France. The second is another city located on a famous river, Washington, D.C., on the Potomac, of course. And the third city in this little parable is a city that was renamed a couple of times over the course of the 20th century. And the century opened, it was called Tsaritsyn. Today we call it, after the river on which it's named, Volgograd. But at the time our story unfolds, it was called Stalingrad. And if there's any point or place in time and space that is the pivot of World War II, it is Stalingrad, for a reason I'll get to in a moment. Now, our story unfolds in quite a defined frame of time, about a six-month period, from August of 1942 to February of 1943. In that roughly six-month period, things happened in these three cities that, if we understand their logic, we'll understand pretty well, I think, the pattern of American grand strategy in World War II, and we'll understand why Churchill got it right in 1945 when he said, the United States stand at this moment at the summit of the world. Okay. Chapter 1, Rouen, August 5th, 1942. Not one of these dates that's emblazoned in our collective memory, like December 7th or 9/11 or November 22nd, but a very significant date. On that date, a squadron of exactly one dozen B-17 bombers under the command of the United States Army Air Force, there was no separate Air Force command at that time, took off from their base in the south of England, transited the English Channel, dropped their bomb load on a railroad switching yard in Rouen, and returned to base. And by the usual metrics of how these things were measured in World War II, it was a highly successful raid. All the ordnance dropped on the primary target, no damage to aircraft, no loss of crew. That's not why it's important for us here today. It's important because we see on that date the implementation, August 5th, 1942, of a decision made about a decade earlier in the early 1930s that in the event of a future war, God forbid if the United States should get involved in such a thing, it would make its principal bet and its principal investment in a new type of warfare called strategic bombing. And strategic bombing is a doctrine of warfare that promised to be revolutionary. It was, its basic idea was laid out in a book published in 1922 called The Command of the Air by an Italian theorist named Giulio Douay. Two countries read this book very, very seriously and configured the totality of their armed forces around this central component of a long-range strategic bombing arm. And the two countries were the United States and Great Britain. Other countries built some strategic bombing forces, but they did not put those forces at the center of their whole force configuration the way we did. Now, strategic bombing was a revolutionary concept based on a revolutionary technology, which was the airplane. But Douay's idea in the book Command of the Air was that airplanes should be used not simply to support ground troops, that's what we call today tactical air support, but they could be used for a mission that heretofore had been almost impossible in the annals of warfare, and that was to fly over the traditional battle space and deliver your blow against the enemy's civilian homeland. And you would have two objectives in so doing. One, to so cripple the enemy's economy and infrastructure, communications, transportation, and so on, that he would be unable to support his traditional forces in the field. And secondly, and Douay made no bones about this at all, The second objective was to terrorize the enemy's civilian population so that they would lose their will to fight and press their government to sue for peace. Now, as it happens, the pilot of the lead B-17 on that raid on August 5th, 1942, was a man by the name of Paul Tibbets. Some of you might recognize the name. Just about exactly 3 years later, Paul Tibbets was the pilot of the Enola Gay, the airplane that dropped the first atomic bomb on Hiroshima on August 6, 1945. So 3 years almost to the day. So in this one man's career in World War II, Paul Tibbets' career, the arc of his engagement in the war, beginning with the raid on Rouen on August 5, 1942, ending with the atomic attack on Hiroshima August 6, 1945, we have a pretty good summary example of the centrality of this piece of strategy to the overall American war effort. And the basic idea was that the United States could leverage its industrial superiority, its scientific superiority, its technological superiority. It could wage war in a way that would be sparing of American lives, and it revolutionized the nature of warfare itself by attacking the enemy's civilian heartland. Okay, chapter two, Washington, D.C., October 6th, 1942, just a few weeks later. Much less dramatic chapter, this one. It takes place in the office of a bureaucrat by the name of Donald Nelson. He'd been the CEO of Sears Roebuck before the war. He was at this time one of the dollar a year men who came to Washington to run the war effort. He was the head of something called the War Production Board. The War Production Board's task was to shift the American economy from a peacetime to a wartime footing, mobilize resources from the civilian sector, transfer them to the military sector, and make possible the waging of war. Early in 1942, as Nelson started this process, he was warned by a team of economists, including a later very famous economist by the name of Simon Kuznets, that it was unfeasible to meet the production targets on the timetable that he was trying to reach. This became known internally as the feasibility dispute. It's largely lost to history, but except to wonky historians, but it was a major item of controversy within the government in 1942. On October 5th, 1942, a meeting is held in Donald Nelson's office, and the feasibility dispute is resolved in his favor, and because he had argued that we're distorting the economy needlessly, we'll never reach these targets, we need to slow everything down and scale it back. Two big concrete decisions flowed from this meeting in his office in October 1942. One was to delay the scheduled date for the event that we know as D-Day by just about one full year. It had been originally scheduled for July 1, 1943, and as everybody in this room knows, it actually happens on June 6, 1944. That is the result of the decision made at this meeting in October 1942 to slow that whole business down. The second decision that was made on that occasion was to ratchet back the targeted number of divisions that were going to be drafted, equipped, trained, deployed, sent into battle from 215, which was the original target, to just 90 divisions, leaving 125 divisions worth of manpower to stay at home and work in the arsenal of democracy. Now, the military did not like this decision, and they referred to the second part of it especially as the 90 division gamble. Now, why did they call it a gamble? Well, the basic answer to that takes us to chapter three, Stalingrad, first week of February 1943, just a few weeks again later after this meeting in Donald Nelson's office. Stalingrad, of course, as I said earlier, is the great pivot of the war. It's where the Red Army inflicts the first strategic scale defeat on the invading German army. And the Russians pass from defensive warfare to offensive and begin the great process of driving the Germans back through Russia, the Ukraine, Poland, East Germany, Prussia, back into the streets of Berlin by the spring of 1945. What the Russian victory at Stalingrad did was it laid to rest a great fear that had haunted both Roosevelt and Churchill. That was that the Soviets would either be militarily defeated, the Wehrmacht had defeated every other foe it had faced up to that time on the land, or maybe it wouldn't be defeated, but the Russians would be compelled to suffer so badly that they would seek a political exit from the war, as the the baby Bolshevik government had done in 1918, the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, shut down the Eastern Front. If the Eastern Front had been shut down in 1942 or 43 or so, that would have released something on the order of 300 German divisions to defend the English Channel. The eventual D-Day operation faced a little bit fewer than 40 German divisions. So the event we know as D-Day would have had a very different consequence if this had been the case. So in a sense, the Soviet victory at Stalingrad ratified the viability of these earlier American decisions to fight primarily from the air, to delay the ground invasion of the cross-channel invasion that we know as D-Day by a full year, and to scale back the size of the American armed forces from an anticipated 215 divisions to just 90 divisions. Now, Joseph Stalin had his own way of describing this pattern once he perceived it. And he said this repeatedly to both Churchill and Roosevelt, said it in writing, said it to their face when he met them at Tehran during the war. He said, "It appears that you Americans have decided to fight this war with American money and American machines and with Russian men." A very cynical formulation, but actually a quite accurate description of what happened. Now, since I don't want to stand between you and the rest of the afternoon, I'm going to telescope some of the discussion of the consequences of this warfighting doctrine that I've just described. And first, with reference to the economy. The United States is the only belligerent country of any consequence in World War II that grew its civilian economy while fighting the war. Our two partners in the Grand Alliance, Great Britain and the Soviet Union, in both those countries, the civilian sector shrank by about one-third in wartime. People had about one-third less fuel, clothing, food, all the amenities and staples of civilian life in wartime because of the transfers from the civilian to the military sector were so desperate. In this country and this country alone, the civilian portion of the economy grew by 15%. That's a record that no other belligerent country in World War II could touch, and indeed it's a record that virtually no societies that have waged protracted wars of attrition, such as World War II was, have paralleled in all of history. It's a unique accomplishment and testifies, among other things, to the shrewdness of these decisions to fight on a reduced scale at a later date and a slower timetable, and also to the deep, 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 phenomenally deep resources of the American economy that were able to be mobilized once the will was there to do it. There's a story I like to tell about Macy's department store that makes the point that I'm trying to get at here. Toward the end of 1944, the marketing geniuses at Macy's decided that it was time to hold a store-wide discount sale. And for reasons that have remained ever mysterious to me, the date they chose for this was December 7th, 1944, the third anniversary of Pearl Harbor, big publicized sale. It'd be as if today Walmart had a 9/11 sale. We'd probably find that pretty creepy, but that's what they did. December 7th, 1944, this is a week or two or so before the Battle of the Bulge. It's around the time of the Battle of the Philippine Sea, Leyte Gulf of the Pacific. It's at the height of American military engagement in both the European and the Pacific theaters. The sale is held, and at the end of the day, Macy's toted up the receipts and concluded that they had a higher dollar volume of sales on December 7, 1944 than in any prior day in their history. There is simply no other society that engaged in the war about which a comparable story could be told, and it's just one reminder among many that America's war was dramatically different from everybody else's war in this conflict. Okay, one last note on this, and it's kind of a grisly note to end on. Maybe I should apologize for that, especially since you've all just had lunch. But again, I'm going to resort to my crib sheet here because there's a lot of big numbers, and I want to get them right. But what I'm about to share with you are the numbers of dead by major country in World War II. Start with our first partner in the Grand Alliance, the United Kingdom, Great Britain, 350,000 dead, of whom about 100,000 were civilians. And again, we think World War II is probably the first major war in history, certainly in modern history, where the civilian death toll actually exceeds the military death toll worldwide. China, 10 million dead in the war, of whom 6 million were civilians. Yugoslavia, relatively small country by our standards, 2 million dead, of whom 1.5 million were civilians. Japan, 3 million dead, of whom 1 million were civilians. Most of the Japanese civilian dead killed not in the two atomic attacks, but in the sustained firebombing raids that began in November of 1944. Germany, 6.5 million dead, of whom 1 million were civilians. Most German civilians killed in the combined Anglo-American bombing attacks. Soviet Union, 24 million dead, of whom 16 million were civilians. And the United States, 405,399 military dead in all branches of service, Army, Army, Air Force, Navy, Marines, Coast Guard, Merchant Marine, counted for these purposes as a combat arm. 405,399, not a trivial number, I don't mean to make light of it at all, or to dishonor those people who served. But when you put that number in the scale with the numbers I've just offered you, you begin to get the logic of America's participation in this war. And in a war in which civilian death tolls worldwide exceeded military death tolls, if we turn to the civilian side of the ledger in the United States and look just at the 48 continental states, the states that had a star on the flag in the World War II era, the sum total of civilian dead whose deaths are attributable to enemy action is exactly 6 people. And they all died together in the most improbable place, a place called Gearhart Mountain in the Southern Cascades in the state of Oregon. If you have a mental map of the state of Oregon in your heads, it's a little bit east of Klamath Falls, if you know where that is. It's almost the California border. The dead were a woman, 25-year-old woman named Elsie Mitchell, and 5 children who were with her, ages 9 to 14. Elsie Mitchell was married to the pastor of a local church, and they were taking these children on a Sunday school outing, picnic. The Reverend Mitchell, the husband, drove the vehicle, let them off in this picnic area, went off to park the vehicle, and while he was parking it, he heard an explosion. He ran to the site, and as he later described it, he saw his wife Elsie and the 5 children laid out like the spokes of a bicycle wheel, dead. And what had happened, later reconstructed, is that they had, Mrs. Mitchell and the 5 children, had apparently seen a strange-looking object in the brush, and they started tugging at it to get it out and have a closer look, and it blew up and killed them. And what they found, had found, was a Japanese firebomb. The Japanese made about 10,000 of these. They were made in probably in spaces not unlike this, large auditoriums and gymnasiums in schools, by school children who pasted together panels of mulberry paper with a potato flour paste. The balloons were then taken to a place called 99 League Beach near Tokyo, inflated with helium. Under them was slung a little 3-pound incendiary bomb. They were launched. They had no internal means of propulsion. They were launched into the jet stream, drifted mutely across the Pacific Ocean. The Japanese meteorologists had discovered the jet stream before others. And the idea was these things would fall to Earth in North America and ignite forest fires in the western United States on such a scale that the Americans would be forced to reduce the pace of their war effort in the Pacific. They'd have to divert resources to firefighting in the American West. Now, not to put too fine a point on it, what the Japanese were attempting to do here was wage their own strategic bombing campaign against the United States to strike their blow not at the Marines out there in the Marianas, but at Iwo Jima or Okinawa or where have you, but against the American civilian heartland, and so disrupt it that the war effort would be disrupted and slowed. Now, I'll close with a scene that, take a little poetic license here. I can't prove that what I'm about to describe actually happened, but I do think it's plausible. It's a reasonable historical speculation to try to imagine the following scene. Let's say you're a pilot or a co-pilot or a bombardier or a waste gunner in a B-29 conducting those firebomb raids against Japan in the early part of 1945. And you've taken off in a 500 or 600 plane bomber stream. Your aircraft is powered by 4 Pratt & Whitney 1600 horsepower engines, and you're carrying a scientifically designed bomb load, a mixture of high explosive and incendiary bombs designed, if possible, to ignite firestorms in Japanese cities. Succeeded exactly once, Tokyo, March 9th, 10th, 1945 killed 100,000 Japanese civilians in one night, more than died at Nagasaki. And you're droning on toward the Japanese home islands, and you look out your plexiglass bubble, and you see one of these Japanese firebomb balloons headed the other way across the Pacific. And the flight vectors are such that actually there's a little bit of a passage in there where this is entirely plausible, that the balloons and the planes would have crossed course and one could have seen them. And you might have wondered, what the heck is that? And what it was, of course, was one of these balloons that killed Elsie Mitchell and the five children. And in that scene, as I say, I can't prove it existed, but it's plausible. You have a summation, it seems to me, of Admiral Yamamoto's nightmare and prediction. That if the Americans had time fully to mobilize their economy, fully to mobilize their scientific and engineering resources, they could build weapon systems in such quantity and of such sophistication that Japan would be doomed, and they could do it without massive loss of American life. And that is exactly what came to pass. So I'll just end. I started with Winston Churchill, that remark in that speech in August of 1945, when he said that the United States stand at this moment at the summit of the world. And here are his next two sentences in that same speech. I rejoice that it should be so. Let her use her vast power not just for herself, but for the well-being of all peoples in all lands, and a new era will open in the history of mankind. Thank you.